Hi there, everybody. This is Sheila. It's February the 14th, Valentine's Day, 2010. Sadly, I didn't receive a Valentine's, but that's not to be too much of a surprise. At my age and whatever. Anyway, back to the cassette tape recordings of 2006. And on this one, I am off to Bottisham, Lode, and then a place called Hildersham, which are tied up with the Hasell family. But I haven't played this tape for a while, so there could be something else thrown in as well. So here we are then, going back to 2006 in May.
Right, I think it's the 20th of May, and today when I opened my mail, I'd received a letter from Robert Hasell McCosh, or Hasell McCosh, however you want to pronounce it, from Dalmain, who sent me a nice letter thanking me for providing him with information about the Tudor panelling at Bottisham Place.
Now, this Hasell, or Hasell, I think they call themselves Hasell, he's the owner of Dalmain Mansion up in Cumbria near Penrith, which I visited during my visit to Cumbria in 2006. And we are connected to them, these Hasells or Hasells, back in time. And I provided him the bit of information that they obviously didn't have from the books I've read on their history about Bottisham Place. An ancestor there who we share was John Hassell and his wife Agnes. And there's actually images of them embedded in the panelling within one of the bedrooms of Bottisham Place. And I sent him up some photographs I'd taken of it. Anyway, he provided me with a bit of tree. Anyway, back to the tape recording.
And he also sent me some extracts from family tree illustrations supposedly done by Sir Edward Hasell in the past, but I think they've been copied and revamped by the look of it. But some interesting information on there about my great-grandmother going back so many times, Elizabeth, who went on to marry Sampson Ware, saying that Elizabeth died young, baptised in 1577. It works out about her year, so I'm now investigating this, me and Zara, because there wouldn't have been that many Hassels in Bottisham in the 15th century, so my Elizabeth must belong to, if not Richard, his brother John. They might, you know, but we're going to investigate this, because all the information we've ever received on the net or from other people have said that her parents were Richard and Philippa. So this makes it more interesting and gives us determination to establish our connection anyway. But we said we need to do this now, and we've got the Cambridge records, we've got Bottisham records, Burrough Green records, and we'll soon be able to establish this thing.
Just pointing out there that since that tape recording, I discovered an awful lot about the Hasell family from Bottisham. They were tied up in a cult or a sect called the Family of Love. And this is mainly where yeomen and wealthy farmers belong to this, people of wealth. It was really a dissenters movement that arrived from Europe. John Hasell was involved in it, and so was both his sons. Now, there were certain things that they could do if, say, they didn't like their wife, that she could be disposed of, and the same would apply with daughters. I mean, it wasn't unheard of in those days for them to bump each other off. I mean, the kings and queens of England were doing it all the time. So there was this little bit of a niggle about Elizabeth Hasell, but she's definitely connected to them one way or another, and the Hassels up in Cumberland are probably less aware of what I've discovered than they realised. So anyway, back to the tape again.
So it's all very exciting. We've got the tree illustrations have filled in a lot of gaps for us about people. And different names have come up, and we've even been informed that John Hasell, born 1525 to 1572, he lent Queen Mary 40 marks in her fourth and fifth years of her reign, paid by John Cotton, and it even gave the year that it was paid, and receipt under her ring, or something like that. And Richard, the same, John's son, he lent Queen Elizabeth 30 quid in her 39th year of her reign, paid via Sir John Paynton in 1597. So obviously our ancestors were mixing in very royal circles if they were actually lending the Queen money. So this is all very exciting, all this. We've got lots of history to dig up.
Yeah, that Paynton family that I refer to there, there's great big statues of them in Islam Church. They were quite significant people in society. And so were the Cottons of Lamwade, for example, and that surrounding area. So we've got a lot of people connected one way or another with our Stutfills, Hassels and Isaacsons. Back to the tape.
So I'm just recording this now while it's fresh in my mind, and it gives us a lot of material to investigate. The plot thickens. Just a little memo here about Sir Edward Hasell. He was orphaned when he was about 10 years old while he was down in Cambridgeshire. And he went off to live with Bishop Rainbow and his wife, Elizabeth, who was the sister of Martha and the sister-in-law of the Reverend Edward Hasell. He was looked after by them at the Rose Castle with Bishop Rainbow and Elizabeth Smith. So just a little bit of information that I thought I'd better mention, because it's sort of cropped up just recently. That's it. It also explains why they moved up there as well, I think. It's the 27th of May. I've got my van back. It had to go and have a clutch tightening up, fluid put in. Apparently it's somewhere, so we don't know how long it's going to last, but it cost me 197 quid. That was mainly labour, because they had to take the gearbox out. Anyway, keep our fingers crossed it's alright at the moment. Sara went on the coach to London today, the 27th of May. She's staying at the Hilton Hotel on a business conference and thing like that, to do with whatever she's doing with the computers. So she went off on the bus. She should nearly be there by now. Let me see, she left about, it was going on 3:15, 4:15. Well, she's probably got about another 40 minutes till she gets to Victoria, and then she's going to try and make her way to the Hilton. So I wish her luck. I'll try and phone her later. And I'm looking after the dogs. I've got myself some woolies now, because it hasn't stopped raining here. And that's it. See you later. Right, it's Sunday the 28th. It's 10 o'clock. I'm off for a couple of hours. I've got to leave the dogs while I go and have a wander around Bottisham to take some more pictures of the village. And then I'm going to stop at the garden centre to get some more screening so that we can have a little area outside the kitchen door where we can sit and have our tea in the summer. I've recently been doing some family tree on the wood side, and I've also been notified or had an email via Ancestry.com of a girl called Carol. She hasn't given me her last name, but apparently she's my second cousin, and her grandfather was my uncle Dick, or Richard. So she's provided me with some information, because Richard married my mother's auntie. My mother married Richard's brother, Alfred. It's not incest, but it's just different families marrying into the same family sort of thing. Anyway, Carol's got a mother called Matilda, who, Matilda Wood, it's weird that. She's the daughter of Richard, my uncle. Now, the weird thing is, Carol, she's got four children, three girls, three boys. I've got three girls, three boys. She's 51. I'm 54. One of her children's at London University. Her mother, my first cousin Matilda, I don't know what her married name is, but she lives down in Cornwall. Obviously they're protecting themselves. We haven't given away our surnames yet, or our personal email addresses. But Carol has actually has been living in Bridgewater for the last 26 years. Bridgewater is, of course, the place where my mother was evacuated during the Second World War. She set up home there. I was born and grew up there as a young child. But Carol lives somewhere in Bridgewater. She said she couldn't locate my sister Margaret, but I don't know about that. And we were living quite near each other, both interested in family tree. I've moved up to Suffolk. She's down in Somerset. But I have told her that I've got my sister down there. But, of course, Margaret won't know quite as much, apart from having the book, of course. The family pack that I gave them all for Christmas, my sisters. So, that was interesting. I've also been doing a bit of the Crispin family. Elizabeth Crispin, I think she was my great-great-grandmother. Yeah, she was. She married John Henry Wood, the fishmonger, in 1847. Of course, they had my grandfather, is John Henry Wood, who married Elizabeth Merritt, my grandmother, of course. But anyway, the Crispins. Elizabeth Crispin's dad, I believe now, is William, and his mother was Hannah Ann Crispin, née Turner. So I'm trying to find her parents now, from Bethnal Green, and to try and trace the William. There were a lot of Williams born at the turn of the century. You know, I mean, turn of the 18th. Into the 1800s, or whatever you call it, 19th century. So I've got to try and trace him. I'm waiting to hear back from Carol, because she reckons that there might be French and Huguenots or something in the family. And something about underwriters for a shipping company. So I don't know quite what she's on about at the moment, or who she's linking this with. Because she won't be... Yes, she will be related to the Crispins. The Crispins is the one family I've gone back to almost the beginning of time. As earlier, I've gone back to... They were related to loads of royal people. And they go back through Turkey and back to Israel and everything. But I don't know if we're related to them, but I found a family in England that go back that far. And they were related to all the kings and queens of all over Europe. From Norway to Sweden to France to Denmark to... Turkey. So that's quite interesting, if we are related to them, that Crispin lot. There was a Captain William Crispin as well. Some of them, a lot of them originated from the Yorkshire area, and there's a lot of Crispins in Cornwall and Devon. They seem to be the main areas. Yorkshire, Cornwall and Devon. so I've got a lot of tree to do, but I'm off to Bottisham now to take some pictures. I'm at St James's Church, Lode, Long Meadow, which is over the other side of the road from Bottisham. I've heard it mentioned when I've been doing different history studies. Lode with Long Meadow. There might be something here. I'm just having a quick look round. Come across some marsh graves. Of course, the grass is about 6 foot high at the moment. There could even be a ceremony going on. It's 11 o'clock. Ships. Susan's ship. Both died the same year, 1910. Susan Ship and Rebecca, wife of Joel Ship. Somebody has started to cut the grass though. I'm just looking for any local names. Stumbling over graves en route. Quite a big ship presence. A lot of ship graves in here. Frederick Wright, Sidney Claude Stinton, oh, I found an Edith Isaacson here, mother of the above, who died February the 24th, 1938, age 84, in memory of Charlotte, wife of Herbert Stevenson. Died March 20th, 1917, he's 25, so she's the daughter of Edith Isaacson, who would have been around in the 18th century. Oh, there's some more here. Next to that one, there's, God, that's a big name, I don't know how to pronounce that. Chedorlaomer Isaacson. Chedorlaomer. Isaacson, who died February the 9th, 1911, age 61. Also, Chedorlaomer Isaacson.
Right, I'm just turning the tape over a minute. It sometimes does happen. Let's turn the tape over.
Chedorlaomer Isaacson, who also died November the 10th, 1928, age 79. So I've come to this place without planning and come straight across some Isaacson graves. So that means there could be more in here. It's interesting. So William Parnell, who died 1906, age 70. And Sarah, his wife, who died 1908, age 72. There's actually a John Bull as well. Died August 28th, 1895, age 31 years. There's a William Bentley Flack, who died 1913. I think it's 19 years. Flack. There's a Francis John, beloved husband of Francis Fletcher, who died May the 7th, 1914, age 74. And Francis Fletcher died May the 15th, 1930, age 80. Oh, and Annie Frances Isaacson, eldest daughter of the above, who died May the 24th, 1915, age 37. So Isaacsons keep appearing here. They keep cropping up everywhere. Great big rectangular monument with one upright stone of John Osborne, who died 1902, age 85, and their son Jonah Osborne, who died 1907, age 52, and Jane, who died 1916, age 52, and a Charlotte Ann Fry, who died 1919, age 58. There's more Bull people in here as well. Samuel Bull, husband of Mary Bull, who died January the 22nd, 1917, age 76, and Mary Elizabeth bull who died 1932, age 80 something. Seems weird not having Zara here. We've got Charles Henry Millard, who died 1931, age 79, and his wife Mary, who died 1939, age 88. Some greens, more Cornells, some more Wrights, some more ships. Gertrude Louise Ship, wife and mother, died 1947, age 56. And Joel, we mentioned them earlier, Ship, who died 1969, age 77. Some Wattses in here. Of course, the Isaacsons are important because we're trying to trace Anne Isaacson's family. And Burwell, Bottisham, Stoke-on-Quay, all that are very near to each other.
Just looking back then, we're trying to trace Anne Isaacson's family. What an awful long way I've come since then. Mind you, it wasn't that long after that, really, once I started digging around in the archives, that I started linking up the Isaacsons with the Stutvilles. Those were early days.
Lots of Harvey family. This is nearer, this is like in the 50s. Harts. Oh, what a move from when I was started off doing this in Burrough. Now I am miles away. More bull family. Seems weird. I'm tracing my own now. Found another Isaacson. Arthur Isaacson died 23rd of February 1950, aged 78. And his wife Rachel, who died 25th of February 1955, age 81. That's interesting then. Another Isaacson. Oh yeah, there's lots of heirs as well. Jabez Ayres died 1891, age 55. Harvey John Ayres died 1918, age 73. And then was Hilda's wife, died 1923. John Ayres, who died 1911. Age 76, and Mary, who died 1916, age 85. Now over the other side of the graveyard. Over here we've got some Isons. William Ison, husband of Elizabeth Ison, died 1916, age 60. Next to that one, another big one, is Sidney Ison, son of William and Elizabeth Ison, who died July the 4th, 1901, age 20. And then there's behind them, there's lots of webs. Whole row of family webs. Just going to have a look. Some Lawrence family, Susan Lawrence, who died in 1900. 84. Charles Millard died 1909, age 65. And Easter Millard died 1911, age 68. So the Millards. I've gone right round the church now, clockwise, on the other side. Coming up near the door to the church. There's some Fisons. A Nottage, unusual name. A few Nottages here. Alfred Nottage, who died in 1895, age 52. They're all over the place, these people, facing one way and then another. I'm literally walking in 4 foot of weeds at the moment on this side of the graveyard. Quite a lot of upright stone crosses over this side. More ships as well. To the Sarah Ship, wife of Robert, who died 1862, age 70. Robert Ship, who died 1866, age 77. There's a lot of ships here. There's an upright, marbly looking plinth of William Thomas Clark, eldest son of William and Harriet Clark, who died 16th of February 1957, aged 77, and Evelyn Lilly, wife of Reginald Chinnery, only daughter of William and Harriet Clark, and dear mother of Cynthia, died in 1957, aged 59. On top of the plinth is like an urn with a cloth draped over it, in loving memory of Henry Albert, the youngest son of William and Harriet Clark, who died 1914, aged 26. Church is locked. In the new part of the graveyard at Long Meadow, we've got new stones. We've got John Isaacson, husband and father, died August the 20th, 1980, aged 66. And his wife, Astus, or S.A. Jane Isaacson, died 20th of August, 1986. So she died the same date, but different year. She was 71. And next to them, you've got some flacks. You've got Florence May Flack, who died 11th of July, 1980, age 83. And Sydney John Flack, who died 1990, age 92. And we've got flacks in the family. There's also some, a Raymond grave, Richard Arthur Raymond, who died the 2nd of May, 1986, aged 82. And Doris Edith Raymond, who died 23rd of May, 1989, aged 82. We've got Raymonds in our family as well, of course. So, and next to there, you've got David John Fletcher, who died July the 27th, 1986, aged 66. And Joyce May Fletcher, who died November the 2nd, 2002, aged 78. And you've got a few heirs' graves. Always reminded me of Pam Ayres, but I don't suppose it's any relative. This is important to do more modern graves, if you like, because it's all for the future as well, as well as the really old ones. Another Isaacson. On my way past, and Elizabeth and Bill Wood, who died 1980, both of them, but probably no relation to me at all. As Elizabeth Isaacson at the back here, died November the 30th, 1973, aged 69. And her husband, David Samuel Isaacson, died March the 2nd, 1976, aged 74. Of course, these could link back to the Isaacsons when we know which one's ours. So it's all useful. Like I said, I never planned to come here. This was spontaneous. Right, so I came back today. It's Monday, bank holiday, May. She came back from London at her trip to the Hilton Hotel. I picked her up from Bury St Edmunds, and because we had some time, we thought we'd go off to Hildersham, where Reverend Edward Hassell and Martha are buried, also where they married and where Sir Edward Hassell was christened. Anyway, we made our way off with big black clouds surrounding us as we went up the A11 towards Linton. And when we got to the village, after a little bit of getting lost and all that sort of thing, it was heavy rain, there was thunder and lightning, real bad. We parked up in Hildersham, but the weather was too dangerous really to get out and explore. We did eventually see where the church was, but we decided we'd come back another day because, you know, you've got to be prepared for these weather conditions, and I don't think you can go out in lightning. So basically we came back because we were worried about the dogs in case the storm had hit a little well neath them. Of course, when we got back here, the weather's changed, hasn't it? But we will go back. We know where it is now, so we will go back and look at that little village shortly. Right, I think it's around about the 30th of May, something like that, isn't it? It's, it could be Tuesday. And I decided I was going to go to Cambridge University and the Cambridge Record Office, but I didn't get up early enough because Louis was howling because Brandy's on heat and he's disturbed, so I didn't get a lot of sleep last night. So I thought I'd go off to Cambridge, up to Newmarket, and find parish registers, go find the record office and all that sort of thing. So I set off about one-ish, half one, something like that. Then she found somewhere to park, not the easiest of places with a camper van, Newmarket, but I did find somewhere where there was lots of spaces and it was by the racing track, so I might try that again another time. Anyway, I made my way to the library in the Rookery, which is like a new shopping centre. The library is sort of in there. I found the local history selection, not too bad, not a massive selection, but there were bits and pieces, but I didn't get anything out at the moment. And then I went to the reception. They don't seem to know a great deal, but they did inform me there were no records kept in Newmarket itself. I'd have to go back to Bury St Edmunds. So, what happens if someone dies in Brinkley, which is in Cambridgeshire, but the registration district is Newmarket then? How does that work? That's what I forgot to ask today. When I eventually came back to Bury St Edmunds and went to the record office, after a massive walk across town to locate it, having to park the other side of town, because I haven't located a car park that side yet, but I no doubt will, because I'm going to need to spend time. Now in there it's all fiches, and you know, it's not a computer, it's you have these either strips of microfilm, or you have you know, rolls of things to look at. So basically, by the time I got started, it was about 4:20. It shut at 5. So by the time I've learnt the system, which is all filed in big filing cabinets, in envelopes, all handwritten and everything, and worked out how to use the machine, and realised it was going to be a very laborious task, I did locate some of our family, which I knew about anyway. There's some Isaacsons. There's an Anne Isaacson, baptised in 1773 to a William and Sarah Isaacson. So I go back and look in my records to see who she ended up marrying, because she might have ended up marrying that Holden bloke. So I'm still looking for Anne and Isaacson. I might have to locate them in the Cambridge records, because James Mason, the father of Elizabeth Mason, we think, so he might not be. You know, this isn't definite yet. I need to locate Elizabeth and Thomas Moore, because it might give the parents, you see. So I need to go back to Bury St Edmunds, really, to locate their marriage, to see if it gives the parents for sure of Elizabeth Mason. Because sometimes you can assume things. Ah, you found Elizabeth Mason, now that's the parents, X in, but there could have been another Elizabeth Mason, you see. So one has to be on one's guard. So anyway, it looks like it is her, because I got her birth as well. But to confirm it, I'll go to those records, really, before we get carried away, and locate her birth, her parents. I think that's the best thing to do. Because her parents are James Mason, you see. Right. It could be the 1st of June, it might be the 31st of May, but I'm off to Cambridge. It's about 8 in the morning. I never got to Suffolk, Bury St Edmunds in the end, because I had to take Zara for her visions meeting to do with setting up her small business. So I'm now going off to Cambridge for the first time. It's weather's awful still. Cold, raining. You know, we never know when it's going to improve. So I'm going off to have an exploration of Cambridge. Hopefully find the records office and quickly look up Elizabeth Hasell's marriage and her parents. That's a big thing today. Right, I'm not sure what the time is, but I've arrived at Hildersham Church, the little village, and gonna have a look round. Right, this is Holy Trinity Church, Hildersham. Just come in the porch way. Can't find any evidence of any graves, but then from the 16th century, wouldn't expect anything visible outside. I met a lady coming out of the church, and so it's still open, so I'm going in. Can't see any time as the witch. It's pretty dark in here. But now you turn the lights on, even not that as well. I'm just going to write something in the book in a minute. I'm going to put some more lights on in a minute. Ah, yes. There's a picture of a brass robin in Ely Cathedral of a Henry Paris. Hildersham, Cambridge, 1427, son of an important local official, Robert Paris, Henry. Henry is known from research to have died before the 1st of June 1427 when a writ was issued to determine what lands he held. He stands on a lion and wears plain armour without mail elements. It doesn't look possible to go up to the altar. There's gates closed with warning that area beyond these gates is protected by security equipment. So I imagine you're not allowed to. I don't know if you're allowed to go in there or not. Don't want that. Don't know, I'm just trying it to see if they open. No. Lock, special lock. They obviously don't want people to go in there. It's very decorated, this altar bit. It's almost like it's been wallpapered. Of course, if there's any plaques up there on the floor about them, I won't be able to see. There are some brass plaques. But it looks like you can't get in there to view it. Which is a shame, because there might be something on the wall. So that's that. There's no plaques on the floor, no plaques on the wall. I've just seen something on the floor. Somebody who served the office of High Sheriff in this county in the year 1780. Deputy Lieutenant, in memory of Thomas Rumbold Hall, Esquire. Who died July the 11th, 1799. The plaque on the floor there. There's no evidence of the Hassells in here. There's no mention of any Hassell names. I'm still having a look round. There's several Smiths that were reverends here in the round about the time Reverend Edward Hassell and Martha were here. Martha was the daughter of Dr. Smith of Cambridge University. But I can't see any. They won't let you go up near the altar where there are a couple of brass plaques and other interesting features. It doesn't look like you can go up there. Hasell was also christened within that church I've just been in, Holy Trinity, Hildersham. He was actually christened in there. Now, could have been warned about the problems of parking in Cambridge, I've spotted a park and ride. So I've decided, it's only up just up the road from here, I'm going to go and do the park and ride. I've just got to be prepared for a lot of walking. It's quite nippy, so I didn't really want to put my jumper on, but I've got my raincoat. I suppose I could put that on, that'll keep me a bit warmer. Nice little, pretty little church, set in a pretty little village. But there's no sign of the Hasells there, but it is a long time ago. But, and I didn't really record any of the graves around there. Didn't identify any names that were known to us at the moment. But it was nice to go and visit it. It's pretty inside. Right, it's 1740. I've just got back from the park and ride to the park and ride park from the centre of Cambridge. I've had a very fulfilling day. A lot of walking as well. I found the records office and I managed to search through things in order to establish the marriage, birth and death of Elizabeth Hasell. Found her birth, found her marriage. There's no record of her dying. There's no record or anything reference to her being buried or anything. So my next move is now to go to the Cambridge University Library, where you've got the a certain person's the bishop's, yeah, bishop's transcripts. I've got to go for that. It's supposed to be like Fort Knox in there to get in, so, but I think I'll probably be able to manage it because I still am affiliated to Cardiff. You have to make an appointment to go anyway, so I couldn't have done that today. But it'd be worth looking at them anyway, just to get the full picture of things. And
you can now get the bishop's transcripts from Cambridge Archives. They moved them, which is a good thing. Also, Ancestry.com now in 2010 are starting to put bishop's transcripts on as well.
Yeah, I applied through the parish records at the record office. And then I went for pub lunch where they had their lunch break, and then I went back, and then after all that I got loads of leaflets, and I'll go into more depth later. I made my way back to the centre and had a look at all the different colleges of Cambridge from the outside. It was too late to actually go in and have a look at King's College and Trinity College because they closed at 5. So that would be a thing for me and Zara to do at some point. So I've now got not too much of a drive. I've now got to drive back to Bury St Edmunds from Cambridge, more or less, because where I am and the car bus thing is on the outskirts of Cambridge, near Edinburgh's Hospital, all around that way. But I'm starving. I've got myself a hot cup of tea and a donut. So I'm going to eat them and I'm going to phone Zara.
Right, that looks like the end of that particular cassette tape. There is a bit on the other side about my journey back from Cumbria in 2006, where I come down the different motorways and I've only got one gear. But that'll be on another tape recording now. That'll come with the Cumbrian stuff. So that was Sheila then in 2006, jumping around a bit, going to Bottisham Lode, going to Hildersham, having various commentaries about visits to archives. All very useful though. Over and out.